Day Church. Let's open in prayer. How did that prayer make you feel? Did you say amen? Or if I could see your face right now, would you be confused? If you're here, you possibly have questions. Or you saw the title of this video and you're just curious. Maybe you are a practicing believer and just came across this video. But I'll take my hours of research and experience and pack it into about 15 minutes of your attention if you want to continue. You can pause, you can Google, you can reference, and even post your own thoughts below. This is just something that I feel needs to be put out there, and I feel that God's putting it on my heart to do so. Those like me, searching for answers. Right now, let's close our eyes and actually pray, one that we can understand and hear. Father God, thank you. Thank you for the love you've shown us through the example of sacrifice in Scripture. Let it be a tool for all of us to have a drive to learn and understand. As it says in Matthew 18, verse 3, let us turn from our sin and become like children. As children are like a sponge and soak up everything around them, always learning. Let us soak up your word and help us to understand your word, how you intended it, that you have given us to use. I pray that all of those watching can take away our pride and see things in your perspective through love and examples in your word and how you intended us to hear it. I humbly pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, church, as this is one of my first actual sermons on a topic of discussion, I also want you to keep in mind I'm not perfect. I don't have all the answers, and I'm always learning, and I'm definitely no scholar. However, I know God has given all of us a purpose, and the key to us finding that purpose is through the unique gifts and talents that each one of us have. The instruction manual to utilize those gifts is through a single book. It is the account of God's action in the world and his purpose with all creation. That book contains work of over 40 human authors. Do you guys know what book I'm referring to? It has 66 books with a total all-containing message given by God, desiring us to have. One of the biggest separations between beliefs, religion, is its context, in that it was and has been translated incorrectly, because it has the hands of human translation. However, understand, as copies have been made down through the centuries, the scribes who made those copies were extremely careful as they did their work. How do we know this? Well, there are over 5,000 complete or partial copies of the originals. Actually, copies of copies. Yet these thousands of copies, which I might add, predate the printing press, all agree with each other to an amazing extent. There is no variation in any of them. And the coolest part? There is no other book from ancient times that has this much underlying documentary support. Getting into that one would definitely be a whole other time of discussion, because we could get pretty deep. What I want to discuss today has been very heavy on my heart. And I hear that God wants his people to know and to understand how damaging it can be to use the gifts of the Spirit in a way they were not intended to be. It affects your spirit, your growth, and your oneness with Christ. And most importantly, it affects the people around you believers and non-believers. So before I get into today's topic of discussion, I first want to come to an understanding of when I say good day, church, what and who exactly am I speaking to or referring to in a biblical understanding of what the church is. The word church in the Bible comes from the Greek word ekklesia, which means a called out company or assembly. Wherever it's used in the Bible, for example, in Acts 19, 30 to 41, it refers to people. In Acts 7, verse 38, the children of Israel. And in Ephesians 1, verse 22, the body of Christ. The word church we see used three different ways. First, as the body of Christ, this would be like a local assembly group of believers, like a church, a building. Secondly, it is defined as the body of individual living believers. And finally, it is defined as the universal group of all people who trusted Christ throughout the ages. I just wanted you to have a complete understanding of what it means when Scripture is referring to the church. So at this point, I hope I haven't lost you or added any extra confusion up until this point, and we have an understanding of what God's Word is and how important it is to understand it and apply it to the church. And now, speaking in tongues. So many people are confused by it, and I know some are even uncomfortable around others chanting it. Now understand, this is not about if it's right or wrong. For me, and what I have seen and come to understand, spiritual gifts are of today. In Mark 16, verse 17 and 18, "And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." God didn't put an expiry date on this, and it's very exciting to see God work in this way. If you've never witnessed or seen God work in this way, I challenge you to pray for Him to show you. What's been heavy on my heart is, when is it appropriate to speak in tongues based on Scripture? And I'm referring to the utterance of tongues. Now keep in mind, from my understanding, there are three types of tongues talked about in Scripture. Right now, I just want to talk about what those are and where they are located in Scripture so we can understand the differences of when and where they are used. So the first of speaking in tongues in parts of Scripture refers to understanding an actual native language. This example comes out of Acts 2 during the Pentecost, verse 3 and 4, where it says, "And tongues spreading out like a fire appeared to them and came to rest on each one of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them." And this is understood even better as a native language and not just utterance. In Acts 2, verse 11, it says, "Both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians were here," stated, "we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God." The second of speaking in tongues in parts of Scripture is the heavy one on my heart. That many people today are throwing around publicly in worship and in prayer. And that is the gift of tongues referred to in 1 Corinthians 14, verse 2. "For one who speaks in a tongue," now we're referring to the utterance, "speaks not to men, but to God. For no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit." Some will refer to this as the angelic tongues or tongues to God to edify your spirit. What needs to be understood is in verse 2. It states that no one understands them, and there is no direction for interpretation here. Now, would this not mean that tongues is an utterance, is a form of prayer for oneself between them and God? This next scripture is absolutely key to understanding the use of tongues as an utterance and will help you understand when we use tongues. to God, and also the third type of tongues, which is prophecy. In 1 Corinthians 14, verse 27 to 28, if anyone speaks in a tongue, this referring to the utterance which no one understands, two, at the most three, should speak, one at a time, and someone must interpret. If there is no interpreter, the speaker should keep quiet in the church and speak to himself and to God. Now, notice how this referred to keep quiet in the church. And this is why I first touched base on understanding what the Bible was referring to when it mentions church. Also, let's touch on 1 Corinthians 14, verse 4. Anyone who speaks in a tongue, referring to the utterance that no one understands, edifies themselves. But the one who prophesies, that was the third one we touched on, edifies the church. Now, the prophecy part of it as well would be back to needing two, at the most three, should speak one at a time, and must have an interpreter. The key word being edifies themselves. And therefore, why should this be spoken out loud or heard by others around without it being translated, when there is supposed to be love and compassion shown to others around you, when only confusion is cast out? Understand, church, I personally speak in tongues at times of prayer to myself, but to myself only and God. I believe there are those out there that know who you are and feel the understanding and conviction I'm preaching about today. Don't do things because others are doing them. Follow the instruction manual that God left behind for you. Bring those around you closer to God's word and not farther away with confusion. Love and forgive always. In closing, I just want to read a few key verses that I feel important to this topic. In 1 Corinthians 14, verse 1, pursue love and earnestly desire the spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy. 1 Corinthians 14:14-16, for if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. What am I to do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will pray with my mind also. I will sing praise with my spirit, but I will sing with my mind also. Otherwise, if you give thanks with your spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say amen to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you are saying? 2 Timothy 4, verse 2, preach the word and be ready in season and out of season. Reprove and rebuke and exhort with complete patience and teaching. 2 Timothy 3, 16-17, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. I want to thank all of you, church, for taking the time to hear the whole session here. I pray and I hope this helps you understand God's word a little better, from what I have read and my understanding. If I'm wrong, I pray that God convicts me of that. But this is my understanding of Scripture and what it says. I know that there's lots of people with their own opinion and in their own interpretation. But I just trying to share God's love. Hope everyone has a great week. Great day. Stay safe out there with the coronavirus. Everyone's pretty stressed out. I know it's a rough and tough time for some, but have faith. Fear not, for God is on your side. Peace and God bless.
Thank you.